polygenic inheritance. Polygene means more than one gene. Hello, this is Dr. Pankaj Kumar, your mentor for today's sessions. So in this session, we are going to study about polygene. Polygene is one of the exceptions of Mendelian inheritance. Okay. So first of all, let's acquaint ourselves what exactly is a polygene and how it is an exception to the Mendelian concept. Okay. So first of all, as I told you, polygene, more than one gene. So if one character at the same time is actually being controlled by more than one gene, then this is what we call is a polygene. So all those genes are together controlling one single character. Okay. So this character is going to show a very specific bell shape distribution curve, which we will show later on. And this is what we call continuous inheritance. Okay. And whatever the phenotype with what we see, that is an additive effect of all gene. Okay. Suppose there are three gene. So that means the eventual effect of the phenotype depends upon the combined effect of all the three gene that is present over there. Okay. Very interestingly, it is also going to influence by the environment as well, right? So that is yet another important thing what we see in case of polygene. Though the different workers has done work on the polygene, but the very first work in case of polygene that was identified in the form of kernel color of wheat, that was way back by Nelson and LA. And later on, Davenport has worked on the human skin color. That is also a polygenic trait. Okay. So let's see that what are the things in case of polygene and how actually it is different from Mendel. You know, the very first things. You know, the very first thing. Mendelian inheritance is a discontinuous inheritance. Why it is discontinuous? Because suppose if you take a trait, let it be say tall and dwarf. So Mendel visualized only two things. Either the plant can be tall or plant can be dwarf. He hasn't visualized anything in between tall and dwarf. Right. But the polygenic inheritance is visualizing the condition that is going to exist between tall as well as the dwarf. So that's why it is different. Second, we always say that Mendelian inheritance is qualitative. Why? Because it is talking about quality of a one particular character. For instance, tall is a one quality, dwarf is a one quality, right? So that's why we say it is a qualitative inheritance. But the moment we talk about the polygenic inheritance, it is a net effect of the combined effect of gene, right? So what will be the outcome of the phenotype? It entirely depends upon what is the contribution of all the dominant gene in the given things. So that's why it is quantitative in nature. Okay. In case of Mendelian inheritance, what we see that the phenotype is a resultant of the effect of a single gene, but here this is not the case. The phenotype is a resultant of more than one gene. That is why we are calling them a polygene. And last but not the least, that is the Mendelian inheritance is not going to be influenced by the environment, but polygene is definitely, or polygenic inheritance is definitely, is influenced by the environment. Okay. Let's see that how the very kernel color is actually being worked out by the polygenic inheritance. Okay. You know, kernel color in wheat is a quantitative trait, right? And it is controlled by two different genes. Okay. So what we will see that the heterozygote is going to be intermediate in color. Okay. So in F2, what we will see that this is going to segregate in the fashion of 1,4,6,4,1, not 9,3,3,1, because 9,3,3,1 is a Mendelian character. But here it is going to segregate in 1,4,6,4,1. Mind it, the mid character is 6 and left and right is the same things. Whenever you see any distribution like this, then this is a typical character of polygenic inheritance. Okay. So once again, this one is depicting that it is very much similar to one of the parent. This 4 is depicting that is it is more towards the dominant parent. This 6, that is intermediate of dominant and recessive. This 4 is towards the recessive parent, and this is a recessive character. Okay. We can see these things in detail. For instance, let's see here. Suppose this is a dark red. So that wise, let it be say two gene R1 and R2. Both are polygene. Okay. So R1 and R2, this is going to show you the dark ray, and its recessive variety R1 and R2 is going to show you the white color. Both are crossed, we are going to get heterozygous, and in case of heterozygous, it is a medium red, right? Now we selfed. As a result of selfing, you will see the phenotypic ratio is going to be 1:4:6:4:1, right? The genotype remains the same. That is 1:2:2:4:1:2:1:2:1. The genotype will remain the same for these two genes, right? But if you see the phenotype, in case of phenotype, what we see, that one is just equivalent to the dark red. The second one, the medium dark red. So these are the two medium dark red, right? Then we have a medium red, and again there is going to have a mediator. So this is going to give them the 6. So altogether we say that the typical ratio of 1:4:6:4:1 is obtained. So that is why how you can see that the F2 phenotypic ratio is deviating from a typical Mendelian F2 ratio of 9331. That is for two gene. If you increase the gene, ratio will be entirely different. Okay. For instance, we can generalize this entire thing like this. If there is a one pair of polygene, the ratio will be 1:2:1, right? The number of phenotypic class is equal to 3, right? This is 1, 2, 3. And number of individual in F2 population, this is equal to 4, because 2, 1, and 1, this become 4, right? Similarly, if the number of polygenes is equal to 2, what we see, the F2 phenotypic ratio will be 1:4:6:4:1, as you can see. The number of phenotypic class is equal to 5. The number of individuals in F2 population is equal to 16. You can calculate, you can add up all this, you will get a 16. Okay. Then, if the number is going to be 3, then the ratio will become 1:6:15:20. Again, you see the left side and the right side, both are same. This is a typical character of the polygenic inheritance. And number of phenotypic class is equal to 7. And the number of individual is equal to 64. Right? So we can generalize everything, right? For we can say for n number of pairs of polygene, we can say the phenotypic class is going to be 2n+1, and number of individuals is going to be 4 to the power n, right? So likewise, if you see here, if I keep 4 to the power 1, we will get this. If we keep 4 to the power 2, we will get this. If we keep 4 to the power 3, we will get this, right? So these are the usual questions which is asked with reference to what could be the possible number of F2 individuals in a population. So by using simple formula, you can get it. Okay, let's see one questions which is actually usually asked. Now you see, when a red grain variety of wheat is crossed with another white grain variety of an F1 hybrid is produced, right? On selfing, we have to calculate how many offsprings of F2 generation resemble phenotypically to their parents. Now we know very well that this polygene is going to be controlled by 3 pairs of polygene, right? So since it is controlled by 3 pairs of polygene, we know the F2 phenotypic ratio is going to be 1:6:15:20:15:6:1, right? Out of these, this one and this one is a parental one. It is similar to the parental one, right? So out of 64, how many parental one? This 1 plus 1, this become 2, okay?